Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you this morning, oh God. We worship you. We worship you. Listen, I can do all I can. I can sing as hard as I can. But listen, at the end of the day, it's about your worship. It's about your worship. It's about how you feel about our God. It's about what you think about our God. It's what you feel about our God. And when you get that in your mind, hallelujah, when you get that in your mind and you think about how good God is, when you think about how he has kept you day after day after day, when you look back over your life and you see all the things that he's kept you through, but then think about the things that you didn't know he was keeping you through, hallelujah, it makes you want to just shout, hallelujah, God. You are good. You are good.
Amen.
You are good.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Father, we thank you.
We worship you, Jesus. Bless your name, God.
Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah, God. When I think back, hallelujah, and I don't have to think back that far. Hallelujah. Hey, I don't have to think back that far. I can think about what he did for me yesterday. Hallelujah. It makes me want to shout. Hey, glory. Hey.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Hey.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Come on. Come on. Sing with me.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Hey.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
You deserve it.
You deserve it.
Belongs to you.
Don't y'all pay me no
mind.
I'm a worship
him. We worship
him.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Hallelujah. Hey.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Hey, Father, you deserve it.
You deserve it.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
All the glory. All the glory. Hey, all the glory.
All of the glory belongs to you.
All of the glory belongs to you, Lord.
Hey, all of the glory belongs to you.
Hey. You deserve it.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You deserve it. All the glory and all the honor and all the praise. You deserve it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey God.
We worship you.
We worship you.
We worship
God. Receive our worship.
We worship.
Receive our worship, God.
Worship, Lord.
Receive our worship, God. Yeah. You deserve it, God. Hey, you deserve it, God. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You deserve it.
It's time for us to bow into the presence of the Lord and to pray. There are so many things for which we are thankful. There are also so many things that we want to bring before the Lord. Not that the Lord is surprised by anything that we are enduring. He knew about it before the heavens were created, before the earth was. For he is God. And apart from him, there is none other. God deserves your worship. He deserves your praise. Not just when things are well, but can you praise him when things are not? We're praying today and we're remembering KFCC. We're remembering the pastors and churches of KFOCI, Kingdom Fellowship of Churches International. We remember Dr. Adia Strange, who we've been praying for so fervently. And on Thursday of this past week, she was released from the hospital and went home, and she's recovering at home. We thank God for that. She is still in serious situation, and we know that God is able, regardless of whatever the doctors say, God has the final word. And we stand upon his promises. We're praying for Elder Deborah Anthony, for Sister Marone Gabrea, but we're also praying for all the COVID-19 victims. Nobody knows when we will be past this. We thought we would be past this by now. I'm grateful because God is teaching us an awful lot of lessons during this pandemic, proving over and over again the words of Paul to be true. And we know that in some things, and we know that in a few things, and we know that in one or two things, and we know in this but not that. No, and we know that in all things, God works together for the good of them who love the Lord and are called according to his purposes. That little word all means to the inclusion of everything and the exclusion of none. But Grandmama said all means all. God is working his purposes out. Every time I hear somebody say, I can't wait to get back to normal, I tell them you'll be waiting a long time. Because we will never see normal again. God has given us the opportunity to create a new normal. And we bless God for that. One of the things that is not going to ever change is our ability and our privilege to come into the presence of God and to pray. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. Turn from their wicked ways and seek my face. Then will I hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. God told Jeremiah, call unto me, and I will hear you and show you great and hidden things you had not known. Jesus himself said, this was one of my memory verses when I was growing up, whatsoever things you ask for in prayer, believing, you shall receive. The Bible tells us that it is the fervent, effectual prayer of the righteous that avails much. And so I want to invite you, those of you who are watching by way of live stream, I want you right where you are. If you're in your living room, or you're in your bedroom, you're in your kitchen eating breakfast, wherever you are, I want you to stop right now. And I want you to begin going into the presence of God. I want you to begin to call upon the name of the Lord. If you have a love relationship with God, you ought to know how to talk to him. Amen. Don't worry about your words not being like my words or somebody else's words. It's your relationship. Speak to the Lord of your life. If you have a prayer language, use your prayer language. It doesn't matter. What's important is that you pray and you seek his face. Nobody knows like you what you're going through today. Nobody knows like you what your family stands in need of. I want you to pray, and those who are in the worship center, I want you to pray. I want you to open your mouths and to fill this room with prayer. And then I'm going to conclude us in our prayer time. We're the type of church, we believe in prayer. We don't believe in short, little, canned prayers. We believe in, like the old folks used to say, Bishop, travailing in prayer. Amen. Sometimes you've got to travail in prayer. You've got to go in prayer. You know, a modern contemporary church likes to call it soaking prayer, but in the old church, they called it travailing, where you go before the Lord and you just pray, and you pray until you get a breakthrough. Amen. Anybody would know that type of prayer? You just keep praying until you get a breakthrough, but God brings it. So let's go into prayer, shall we? Let's open our mouths and begin to pray. Let's do it. Let's do it. Let's do it.
Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we thank you this morning. We bless your name. Lord, we honor your name and glorify you. Eternal God of glory, we thank you this morning. The one who is seated upon your throne, O God. Father, Lord, you watch over the affairs of men. Your eyes are going to and fro, O God, on our behalf. Father, we bless you, O God. You have not allowed our enemy to overtake us, oh God. You have not allowed the proud water, oh God, to cover us. Father, we bless you. We honor you. We give you all the praise, oh God. Father, what shall we render unto you, oh God? We render unto you the fruit of our lips, Heavenly Father. We bless your name this morning, oh God. We give you praise, Father. We appreciate you, oh Lord. Father, we forget not your benefit, oh God. You are the God that has delivered us from destruction, oh God. You have healed us of all our diseases, Heavenly Father. We bless you, oh God. We honor you. We glorify you. We magnify your name this morning. We give you praise, oh Lord. Father, thank you for your mighty eye, oh God. Thank you for the power of your word and the ability of the Holy Spirit this morning, oh God. We thank you, Heavenly Father. We bless you, Lord. We give you praise, Heavenly Father. Lord, you are our present help in time of trouble. No matter what, oh God, the enemy does, oh God. Father, we are victorious in every situation, oh God. We are more than conquerors in the name of Jesus. Father, we bless you. We are the redeemed of the Lord. Sickness has no place in us. Coronas has no place in us. In the mighty name of Jesus, we come against the power of the enemy this morning. We destroy the work of the devil in this world this morning. In the mighty name of Jesus, we silence the voice of our enemy this morning. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we bless you. Lord, we honor you. We glorify you. We give you praise, oh God. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We thank you, oh God. You are the source of help and healing, oh God. Father, we thank you for all that we have prayed for in this church, oh God. Father, we thank you, Heavenly Father, for perfecting the help, oh God, of our people. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we bless your name. You are the great restorer, oh God. We thank you for restoring help, oh God. In the mighty name of Jesus. We bless you this morning. We give you praise. We give you honor. We give you adoration. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Gloria, gloria, gloria a Dios. Aleluya. Gloria a Dios. Alabado sea tu nombre, Jehová. Padre, en esta mañana, Dios de misericordia, te damos gloria, te damos honra, te damos gracias, Maestro, porque tú nos permites estar aquí congregados, Dios de misericordia. Padre, en esta hora, Jehová, yo te presento a aquellos que nos están mirando a través de las redes sociales, Señor. Que tú seas tocando las vidas, Dios de misericordia. Aquellos que están enfermos, Maestro, yo te los presento, mi Dios. Arrabacanda, Ucabasaya, Ucababansaya. Padre, yo te pido, Maestro, que tú seas tocando, Señor. Que tú seas levantando, restaurando, Dios de misericordia. Aquellos que están en estado depresivo, Señor amado. Aquellos que están, Dios de los cielos, en estado, Dios amado, que están enfermos, que están postrados en una cama, Dios de misericordia. Aquellos, Señor, que están cargados de problemas y de ansiedad, Maestro, yo te los presento, mi Dios, pidiéndote, Señor, que tú te glorifiques, Señor, que tú envíes una legión de ángeles, Señor, a ministrar a tu gente en esta mañana, Maestro, y que tú seas glorificándote, Jehová. Toca las vidas, Maestro, restaura, Señor, levanta, sana y salva, Dios de los cielos, en el nombre poderoso de Jesús, Señor. Te damos gloria, te damos honra y te damos gracias, Maestro. Gloria a Dios.
Aleluya, aleluya. So, Father, we bless your name. We glorify you. We magnify and exalt you. You alone, O God, are worthy to receive all of our worship, all of our praise. We bow before you, O God, for you are our King. You are the Alpha and the Omega. You are the beginning and the end, and we bless your name. Lord, in spite of everything, you deserve our worship, and we bow before you. Now, O God, we ask that you would give ear to our prayer, that you would move on our behalf. You know wherein we stand in need of your touch. You know where we need to be healed. You know where we stand to be delivered. You know where we have questions that need to be answered. And God, you have everything that we need. So we look to you, O God, for you are our sufficiency and you are our strength. And so in the name of Jesus, we stand upon your word right now. We remind you, O God, of the promises that you have made to us. And we thank you even right now that we're not walking in defeat, but we're walking in victory. And in the name of Jesus, we take authority over every situation and every circumstance. Open your eyes and hold your head up, because devil, we call you by name. You're a liar and the truth's not in you. We command you to take your hands off of the people of God. Loose them and let them go. Now in the name of Jesus. My Bible says that when I mention my Jesus name, you got to flee. So in the name of Jesus, pick up your weapons and flee. In the name of Jesus, we bind up sickness and disease. In the name of Jesus, we bind up everything that has your people bound. And we decree freedom now and victory now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Glory.
And God, we thank you, because whatever we bind here on her earth is bound in heaven, and whatever we loose here on earth is loosed in heaven. Loose now the power of your Holy Spirit, that it might flow from heart to heart and breast to breast in Jesus' name. And we claim the victory now, and we call it done in Jesus' name. Somebody ought to give God some glory. Somebody ought to give him some praise. Hallelujah. You know, I used to pastor in a denomination that didn't like much noise in church. They used to always say, it don't take all that. But some of you have learned it takes all that and some more. And in my more arrogant days, I'd look back at them and I'd say, if you don't like noise, whatever you do, don't die. Because in heaven, they're crying, holy, holy, holy. And my Bible says in hell, there's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Amen. So if you don't like noise, stay alive. Don't die. Amen. Amen. But as long as I have breath in my body, I'm going to give God the glory.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to give God the praise.
Hallelujah.
Glory. Glory to God.
Glory, glory.
Where I don't see a breakthrough, that's why we've got faith. Amen. By faith, I've got it already.
Amen.
I'm already healed in heaven.
Amen.
My body is just waiting to get the email. Hallelujah. Glory to God. It's coming. Amen. How do you know that to be true? And we bless God for it. Somebody clap your hands and give God praise.
Glory.
You at home, go ahead and holler right where you are. Go ahead and bless the Lord
glory, where you are.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. Well, we are so glad that you're here today. Amen. Lady Cece, there's a couple pieces of paper, I think, underneath the earphones. If Brother Sattar, if you could go get that for me, please. Amen. I'm so happy to have all of you here with us today. And I want you to know that you are welcome. Thank you, sir. You are welcome in our presence. Hallelujah. I'm so glad to have our good friends, Bishop McElwain and First Lady McElwain. We bless God for them. Amen. They're no strangers to us. They're part of KFOCI. Bishop McElwain is on our board for KFOCI, and we're grateful to have you here with us today. You are welcome anytime the Lord moves you to come. Amen. Can Brother Sattar, can you come get that microphone for him? Amen. Bring it to Brother Howard. I'll talk for a second while you all get that ready for him. And then we're going to have another guest today to greet you. But while they're getting ready, would you just, you can't go and shake and hug like we like to do, you know. So just turn around and wave at somebody, blow them kisses, stick out your elbow to them, whatever. Just let them know that you're glad to have them in the presence of God today. I'm glad that you're here today. Listen, let me tell you something. If you all don't want to worship him, if you all don't want to praise him, it's all right because Lady Cece and I got you. Amen. Because we've got a reason and a right to praise him today. Hallelujah. We went about 3 weeks where we didn't have an address, stuck between, amen, closing dates that got shifted. But we closed this past week, glory to God, and we moved into our home this weekend. Amen. We just blessed God. Listen, that we got a reason to shout. Matter of fact, at closing, Lady C said, I just tell everything. But at closing, in the lawyer's office, at closing, when the closing was done, Cece just went to dancing. And what I think the paralegal looked at her and said, oh, she's doing the jig. I said, no, she's not. In our church, when we get happy, we dance. Amen. Glory to God, because this is a long process. Amen. And we thank God for it. And God was faithful. May I tell you one other thing, and then I'm going to invite them up. Things kept happening, and the last date that they gave us for closing was for tomorrow. But Lady Cece had heard from the Lord two separate times. The Lord had awakened her out of her sleep and said 18th, 18th. And so when the word came, more than a week ago, about 10 days ago, that we were going to close on the 20th, Lady Cece went back into the presence of the Lord and she said, Lord, they're telling us the 20th, but you said that we were moving in on the 18th. Amen. Last weekend, she said, we're moving in on the 18th. Lord, you said that. You're faithful to your word to perform it. Monday morning, we got a call from our realtor saying, we're closing on the house you're selling on Tuesday and the house you're buying on Thursday. We closed on Thursday, started moving on Friday, and the big move was yesterday. God is faithful to his word. God is faithful to his word. Amen. Don't you wait to act on what you hear from God. If you know God said it, come on, somebody. If God said it, doesn't even matter if you believe it. If God said it, it's already settled. Hallelujah. And so we thank God. We got a reason and a right to praise him. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to go back there and just dance with the Lady Cece. She back there dancing. Somebody go shout with her. Don't let her shout by herself. Hey, go. My. Woo, God. Yeah. Glory to God. My God. God is faithful. Faithful to his word. We bless God. Glory to God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We bless God. Amen. Amen. Listen, you ought to know you don't need to have any music behind you to praise God. Don't worry about them folk in the cars next to you at the traffic light. Go ahead and get your praise on anyhow. Amen. Wave your hand. Shout the glory, whatever you have to do. God is worth it. Listen. Michael sitting up in the window watched as David came in into Jerusalem before the Ark of the Covenant, danced so much he's all the way down to his BVDs. And she, a king's daughter, said, that's undignified for a king. But David basically said, I'll get even more undignified than this. Amen? Because God is worthy of all of our praise. Amen? Isn't he worthy? Bishop Michael, I just want you to come and just greet the people. We're on live stream, so come quickly and just greet the people. Amen. Glory to God. Amen.
Praise the Lord, church. We give highest praise to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and we thank you for the shepherd of this house, and we are just glad to be in your presence today. Everybody talks about COVID and how bad it is, and yeah, we've been wearing the mask and we've been greasing up with all the alcohol and all that stuff, but you know what? It is good to be back in the house, but not only back in the house, God is doing some things. Amen. Because he's showing us how, as a church, we needed to worship him not just on Sunday, not just on Wednesday, but every single day.
Amen.
And every single hour.
Amen.
I've got one presentation that I want to do here, but Sister CC mentioned out on Facebook a month or so ago that our bishop, her husband, was celebrating a birthday. So we sent some shout outs over Facebook.
Amen.
But we wanted to give you something tangible today.
Bless the Lord.
From Refuge of God Christian Fellowship and the rest, we're saying to you, to our bishop, happy birthday. And Sister Cece, you get with my wife. And you, whatever it is that you need there, you let her know. We want to give you something, too, that you can place in your house.
Amen.
As a reminder that God, he's a keeper of promises.
Amen.
So we're just excited to be here today. Amen. God bless you, sir.
There we go.
Amen. Glory to God. Come. Praise God. Lady Cece. Amen. Glory to God. God be praised. Amen. That was totally and completely unexpected, and we bless God for you. Thank you so much. I praise God for that. You know, this past week went to my mailbox, and we had gone up to Durham back in November to help install into a new ministry a couple that had actually been a part of our ministry years ago when we were out on Willing Drive, and they led music for us and worship. They were very strong, and they were starting a ministry, and then had a great time with them. But this past week, they sent us a check because they asked God where did he want them to tithe, and he told them to tithe to Kingdom Fellowship, and totally unexpected, I bless God for that, and so we're thankful for them. That's the Howells. Pastor and Elder Howell, we bless God for them. Praise God for them. Listen, we do have some guests today from the Gideons. Amen. Now, any of you who are unfamiliar with the Gideons, we have a guest that's going to speak on their behalf for them. He'll tell you a little bit more about what they do. But just as a reminder to some of you that if you've ever stayed in a hotel and pulled open the nightstand drawer and found a Bible there, there is an emblem on the front of that Bible generally that says Gideon's. And I just praise God for that ministry. Listen, when I first started pastoring, part of my first job as a 25-year-old was campus minister at Norfolk State University. And the Gideons would come on the campus of Norfolk State University, and they would hand out the little green New Testaments with the Psalms at the back of it. And it was funny because when we'd have Bible study, because those little Bibles were easy to carry, they'd come to Bible study with that little New Testament in them. And I used to joke with them all the time, telling them that that wasn't a sword, it was a dagger. because it was just the New Testament and the Psalms. Amen. But it was a whole lot better than some of those from the Pentecostal background that carried Bibles so big it looked like it was a pulpit Bible, the Bible study. But I appreciate the ministry of the Gideons. I don't know if you know Brother Wesley Everett. Brother Wesley Everett and Barbara Everett, they're in their own ministry now. They were part of our ministry back when we started this ministry and before when we were in the Presbyterian Church. But Brother Wesley is a part, or was, I don't know if he still is now, but was a part of the Gideons. And so over the years, we've had different Gideons to come be with us at different times. And so I want to recognize Brother Ted DeBruel. He's been a member of the Fredericksburg Gideon Camp since 1991, where he currently serves as the president of that camp. Ted has served as chaplain and vice president for the state of Virginia. Ted has also been active in the jail ministry for this camp. Ted and Brenda, his wife of 45 years, have two grown sons, two granddaughters, and one grandson. He has been in the auction business for 42 years, specializing in automobiles and real estate. I need to know you. Amen. He is a former Virginia State auctioneer champion. Wow. Ted has been on special assignment teams that went to Mozambique, Africa, Slovakia, Mexico, Guatemala, Nicaragua, and Argentina, and he is excited about what God is doing through this ministry. Can we give him a big KFCC, KFOCI welcome as he comes? God bless you, sir.
Thank you, Kingdom Fellowship. That's a warm welcome. You can teach all churches how to give a welcome. Please be seated. Who are the Gideons? Yes, they do place Bibles in hotel rooms all over the world in over 200 countries and territories and possessions around the world. You'll find that Bible because of churches just like Kingdom Fellowship who support the Gideon ministry, and we're able to place those Bibles. That's only a small percentage of what the Gideons really do. Who are the Gideons? I was speaking in Kentucky just before this COVID thing hit, and when I pulled up in front of the church on the brick marquee out front, it had, "We support missionaries in 200 countries. Thank you, Gideons International." Now, I submit to you, Kingdom, that there is a little church up there in the hills of Kentucky that has caught the vision of what the ministry is truly all about. Simply an extended missionary arm of the churches around the world as they partner with the Gideons International, an association of Christian business and professional men traveling all over the world at our own expense, so that when we come and stand before churches just like Kingdom Fellowship and others around the world, we can say to you that every penny that is given to the Gideons International goes for the printing and distribution of God's Word 100%. As Christian businessmen, we'll take care of our own expenses. Whether we go from our home in Fredericksburg, Virginia, to Africa, to the deepest, darkest jungles of Africa, we'll pay our own way. So you can see how God continues to bless this ministry as we continue to do what we do. As you've gone about all your tasks and the things that have gone on and all the things that bring doubt, worry, concern into your lives in the last 12 months, especially in the last 4 months, this ministry continues to go on. And God is on the throne. He continues to bless this ministry. Do you realize that God has seen fit to allow us to place over 87 million copies of God's Word into those outstretched hands? That's one at a time, not by the caseload. And yes, people, when they think about the Gideons International, they think about the hotel Bibles, but that's only a small percentage of where those Bibles go. A lot of those Bibles go into the hands of children in classrooms from first grade to college, on those college campuses. And I know a little something, Pastor, about those green testaments. As it's handed to me on a college campus, I neither wanted it nor was I interested in it. And I took it and I put it in my pocket. But let me tell you something. God's Word does not return unto Him void. I promise you, Isaiah 55 is just as relevant today as it ever has been. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. I carried it for 8 years, and a godly wife, my little godly wife, was praying for me, and a church was praying for me. And when a church begins to pray, things begin to happen. After 8 years, I started reaching the bottom of my suitcase, and I started reading the Word of God, and I read it for a year. And I prayed and asked Jesus Christ into my heart in March of 1981. He gloriously saved me, and I told Him I'd serve Him the rest of the days of my life. In March of 91, God called me to the ministry called the Gideons International. He's allowed me to travel all over the world and see literally tens of thousands of people come to the Lord Jesus Christ, from countries and other languages. But listen to me, beloved, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, So Kingdom Fellowship for allowing us to come this morning, give you a small glimpse into what is going on with the Gideons. Please continue to pray that God would open doors for us that we'd be able to step through. We'll be found faithful as your missionary arm out there into a lost and dying world. Continue to pray. If you're a man here, it's a Christian businessman, we'd love to talk to you. And we thank you for your financial support as well. And use the Gideon Card Program to place Bibles in memory of loved ones or special occasion. I want to close with this. I walk by him every morning, but the first morning I walk by and come out of the hotel in Managua, Nicaragua, there he sat. He sat on a little wooden box, and he looked up at me and said, "Shoeshine, mister." I took two steps, and I said, "No, I think I'm okay." And the Lord spoke to my heart, and he says, "He needs it a lot worse than you need that shoeshine." I turned around and I said, "You know, my shoes are a mess. Would you please try to straighten them up for me?" And I sat down and I said, "What's your name?" A little boy, probably 8, 9 years old. I said, "What's your name?" He said, "Sebastian." "Sebastian, has anyone told you today that they love you?" "No, no one's ever told me that they love me." I said, "What about your mama, Sebastian?" "I don't have a mama." I said, "What about your daddy, Sebastian? Has he ever told you he loved you?" He said, "I don't have a daddy. I don't have any family. I live in a cardboard box across that park right there in a cardboard box, and I shine shoes in order to be able to eat." I said, "Well, Sebastian, I want you to know that I love you. But more than anything else, I want to tell you that God loves you. And he'll love you. He'll love you when you're down. He'll love you when you're up. He'll love you all in the darkest hours of the night. He's going to love you, Sebastian." 2 days went by, and the same conversation went on, and I would show him in the back of the book how he could know. And then the third day I walked out, and he said, "Hey, Mr. Ted, shoeshine?" I said, "Sure." Sat down there, and he began to shine my shoes. I said, "Stop. Just stop. Listen to me, Sebastian." I said, "I want you to know, as I opened up God's word, it doesn't matter what a man says, what a woman says, but when God's word says it and God speaks it, it settles it." And I said, "Sebastian, listen to me. It says in God's word, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son," that's Jesus, Sebastian, "that whosoever..." Listen to me, Kingdom Fellowship. Aren't you glad this morning? Aren't you glad as you watch this video this morning? Aren't you glad that the Holy Spirit of God seen fit to put the word "whosoever" in the Word of God? Well, some of you are, but listen to me. Look at me. I'm one of those whosoevers. I know I'm not the very best thing in the world, but listen, I'm one of those whosoevers that in March of 1981, God seen fit by his grace and his mercy to gloriously save my soul. And I'm looking back into the faces of all those whosoevers. It has nothing to do with where you're from, your nationality. It has nothing to do with the language you speak. It has nothing to do with your stature in life. It has nothing to do with the color of your skin. He said, "Whosoever, whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." He loves you, Sebastian. And he smiled. But I said, "There's a problem, Sebastian." And it says, "For all." There's that word, brother. All. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Now, you can lie about it if you want to, but he already knows it. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And then it says, "For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." And then here it is. "For whosoever calls," means to pray and to ask upon the name of the Lord, "shall be saved." He didn't say "might be." No, the Holy Spirit of God said "shall be." Some interpretations say "will be." That's 100% promise in the Word of God. I held little Sebastian on my knee. I looked at him and I said, "I love you, but God will love you. He'll love you for all of eternity when no one else does." And little Sebastian prayed the sweetest prayer I've ever heard as I've traveled all over the world. I've watched thousands come to Jesus, but Sebastian prayed and asked Jesus into his heart. I left that hotel that day and went to maximum security prison out in the country. We put 2,700 copies of God's Word in that maximum security prison. Watched prisoners all over that prison become children of God. And when I got back, tired and weary from having been in the fields because they are truly whitened unto harvest. And when I stepped out of that truck and looked across that pickup gate and looked out through the portico, over through the park, there he sat, a little 8-year-old shoeshine boy. Brother, he had no education. He had never been to seminary. He didn't know any theology. But there he sits on a wooden box, and all the shoeshine boys in that part of the city had gathered around. Now he's holding church, and now that little testament that you loved him enough to send to him. And I believe if you could see it through the eyes of God, you'd see your fingerprints all over it, all over that testament. And I watched that little Sebastian says, "Don't you know that God loves you?" It says right here, "For God so loved the world." And I watched. Pastor Logan listened. I watched and I listened behind that column as that little boy became an evangelist. And I watched him. And he said, it says, "For whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." And I watched all those shoeshine boys, because you loved them enough to send the word of God. I watched those little shoeshine boys get their names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I've come on behalf of the Gideons to say, thank you, brother. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Because you loved them enough to send the word of God. We'll be found faithful. Please help us to continue to get it out there. Thank you, Kingdom Fellowship. Thank you, Pastor Logan. And God bless you.
Hallelujah. Come on, somebody, give God praise. Give Brother Ted, would you step back up here for just a moment, please? I just want to, and I hope we made it out right, I just want to give this to you from my wife and I to the Gideons. We want to be part of, in a tangible way, that distribution of the Word of God. And I want you also to know that Kingdom Fellowship is going to match what we have given today. As a couple, we're leading the way. And anybody who's listening to me, amen. Come on. And here's Bishop McElwain, and he and Lady McElwain are participating in this as well. Listen, I don't want you to take away from your tithe or from your offering, but if you'd like to participate in this, what an incredible ministry. I want to offer you that opportunity to do that. And we bless God for the privilege of participating in the spreading of the Word of God. Amen. So if you're watching and you want to participate in this, listen, if you send it to us, we'll make sure that they get it. Or you could perhaps even go online and find on their perhaps the international website where you can give that way. Oh, look here. Glory to God. Amen. We bless God. Listen, whatever you give is going to come back to you. How's it coming back? Pressed down, shaking together, and running. Was that you, not me? Glory to God. Amen. You're going to get a whooping. Stop that. Amen. Amen. And so we encourage you to give unto the Lord. Listen, we don't want to just be a church that comes and has church. We want to be a force of transformation in the world. Amen. Amen. And as we participate in this, we can say, like that church in Kentucky, that we support missionaries in over 200 countries. Amen. God be praised. Oh, look here. Thank you, Prince. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. We bless God. Amen. God bless you. Come on, give God a praise, would you please? Amen. Amen. You're welcome, sir. It's our privilege. And come on, Sister Bintu. Come on. You come across. Come on across. Amen. Don't worry. He's got. Amen. Amen. Bless God.
Well, having said that, it's giving time. I said it's giving time. Come on, somebody shout the glory. Amen. You're setting yourself up for a blessing. Amen. Deacon Tyrone is going to come with the basket, and we want you to get ready to give today. Listen, those of you who are watching by way of live stream, we're thankful for your faithfulness in giving. Though you've not been able to be in the building, you've been faithful in your giving. And we want to encourage you to continue to be so. We have offered you three different ways that you can give electronically. You can give using the Givilify app, which is on your phone. Amen. We are listed in Givilify as Kingdom Fellowship Christian Center in the city of Charlotte, North Carolina. You can also go on our website to www.kingdomfellows.org, and there is a secure PayPal link where you can give through that link. Or if you have the Cash app on your phone, you can give using the Cash app. We are in the Cash app as $KingdomFellows. That's $KingdomFellows, and we encourage you to give. Amen. So as you get your offering prepared, if you would come and drop it in the basket, amen. And those of you who are watching, come on, let's give right now. Let's give right now. And as you're watching, I didn't say it earlier, but if you did not share this live stream, be sure to share. You can come on. Just come on whenever you get ready. You can share it. Start a watch party. Amen. We bless God for you today. Amen. God be praised. Thank you so much for your giving. Now, listen, this is totally unexpected. I'm excited by this, but Brother Caleb McElwain just told me that he has brought dinner for everyone today. Amen. Amen. Wave your hand, Brother Caleb, but the folks don't know who you are. Amen. This is the McElwains, one of their sons. Oh, yes, sir, I'm sorry. Amen. Amen. Bless God. Amen. So we're so grateful. If you don't have to run when service is over, amen, stay in fellowship. We've got enough tables. We can spread you out. Amen. And make sure that you remain safe. And we just bless God for you. Listen, Brother Caleb, let me lean this way. I'm especially grateful because Lady Cece and I just moved yesterday.
and everything is in boxes. So we're especially thankful. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. They're coming with the sermonic selection now, and once they get finished, I'm going to come with the word for today. Amen. I thank God for our worship and praise team. But for those of you who are watching, if you don't have a place to serve, this pandemic's going to be over soon. I want to offer you as this is being good ground.
Amen.
Amen. Bring your instruments. Bring your voices. Join us in this venture of faith. Amen. But while I say that, I'm so thankful for my wife, Lady Cece, for minister and training, Bintu Bima, for Brother Howard Boyd, our director of our music and our marketing, and for little Prince Boyd, amen. We bless God. That he, young Prince, not little, young Prince Boyd. We bless God for their faithfulness in serving in this regard. We bless God for them. Come on, let's get us prepared for the word of God.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah. God is worthy.
How many of you
worthy.
Know that God is able? Yeah. How many of you know that God is able to do above and all that we could ever ask or think?
Amen.
How many of you know that? Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand to our feet. And this song we all know is He's able. God is able. So sing along with us. Sing along with us. And just worship God and understand. Get that situation in your mind and think about what's impossible or what you think may be impossible. And watch God move now. Because he's activated by our faith. He is activated and released by our faith. And so as we begin to worship him, whether you know the words or not, begin to lift your hands and worship God, our King, together in one accord, in unison, and let's worship him now.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Promise to you,
hey, hallelujah.
Don't give up.
If you believe it, come on, sing with us. Hey, because
He's able.
Hallelujah. I know He's able. Hallelujah.
When you don't know the word, hallelujah. Just say, oh.
Say, ha. Oh.
Look over at somebody from a distance, tell them, don't give up on God. Come on, tell them again, they didn't hear you.
Hallelujah.
If they're not responding to you right, look at somebody else and tell them, don't give up on God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because He's able. Don't give up on God, 'cause He won't give up on you. Don't give up on God, 'cause He won't give up on you. Come on, somebody help me. Don't give up on God, 'cause He won't give up on you. Don't give up on God,
'cause he won't give up on you. Don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. I decree and I declare that he's able. I've heard it said before, if what you're using's not working, if your God's not working, try mine. Try mine. Hallelujah. And I bless God. I want you to get 1 Samuel chapter 30, verses 1 through 8. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verses 1 through 8. And when you get finished, don't put your Bibles away, because we will be in them in different passages of Scripture. I don't have a particularly deep theological word today. Every now and then, the Lord will cause me to state the obvious just to remind us of who he is and what it is that he is able to do. I just want, with your prayers and certainly the aid of the Holy Spirit, to tell somebody yet again that God will come through for you. God will. I said God will. God will come through for you. I don't know about you, Bishop, but you can't make me doubt it. Through the test of time, I've come to know too much about him. And even still, every now and then, I need to be reminded that God will come through. I believe that God has appointed this word today for somebody who finds themselves in a place of doubting and unbelief. God has sent me to speak into your spirit to remind you he's not forgotten about you, and he still will come through for you. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 30. If you didn't bring a Bible, it's on the screen in front of you. If you're watching from home, it should be able to be seen on the live stream. Then it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day. I've read this passage over and over again, but I just saw that. I don't know how many of you, when you read Scripture, God will just lift stuff out. It said that, you got it, Ted, that when they came to Ziklag on what day? See, you didn't shout about it because the third day doesn't mean anything to you. But the number three is symbolic of wholeness and completion. God does something in threes on the third day. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Jonah in the belly of the whale. Three nights. Ah, hallelujah. 3 days between crucifixion and resurrection on the third day. That the Amalekites had made a raid on the Negev and on Ziklag and had overthrown Ziklag and burned it with fire. They took captive the women and all who were in it, both small and great, without killing anyone, and carried them off and went their way. When David and his men came to the city, behold, it was burned with fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters had been taken captive. Then David and the people who were with him lifted their voices and wept until there was no strength in them to weep. Now David's two wives had been taken captive, Ahinoam, the Jezreelitess, and Abigail, the widow of Nabal, the Carmelite. Moreover, David was greatly distressed because the people spoke of stoning him,
For all the people were embittered, each one because of his sons and his daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. Then David said to Abiathar the priest, the son of Ahimelech, please bring me the ephod. So Abiathar brought the ephod to David. David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue this band? Shall I overtake them? And he said to him, pursue, for you will surely overtake them, and you will surely rescue some. A few, one or two, yours but not theirs, theirs but not yours. And you shall surely rescue all. So, Father, we thank you in advance for this word. We thank you that it's already blessed. We ask you now that this word would be released in spite of me, that you would use me to mightily speak to your people. Lord, speak to them even as you spoke to me. And then together may we live more triumphantly and victoriously. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. Look at somebody and tell them emphatically, this is your chance to preach. Look at them emphatically and say, God will. Oh, y'all didn't do it right. Come on, tell them, God will come through for you. Amen. Glory to God. You may be seated in the presence of a living and awesome God. Amen. If you have ever had your back against the wall and felt as though nothing you did or could do would make any difference in your situation, God sent me today with a message for you. By now you already know, and you know all too well, that trouble is no respecter of persons. No amount of money, position, or prominence will prevent tribulation from knocking on your door. It does not matter how biblically literate you are. It does not matter how long you've been saved. Trouble is a reality in all of our lives. No one around you may know the trouble you've seen. No one around you may even know the trouble you find yourself in right now. Because we do not suffer with or through the same things, nor do we suffer with or through them in the same way. You may not be able to share your struggle with others because they would not understand, or perhaps they would think that you're just being overly dramatic. One of the unfortunate tactics our enemy uses with great effectiveness against us is our trouble. He cajoles us. That means he persuades us by flattery or promises into believing that we must be doing something terribly wrong for all of this trouble to have come upon us. And then he conveniently causes us to forget that our enemy has a job, which he does very well: steal, kill, and destroy. But now, you know all of this. I know you have, because I've taught you this and I've reiterated it time after time. And yet, some kind of way, we still have difficulty holding on to our faith, holding on to the promises of God in the midst of our trouble. Now, what I'm speaking to you today is not hyperbole. I mean, it's not obvious and intentional exaggeration on my part. I know well firsthand the pitfalls of trying to manage the various tumultuous times of my life. I know well how difficult it is when you're in the midst of something, regardless of whatever it is or how important it is to you. That's a tough place to be. It's a depressing place to be. It's a nerve-wracking place to be. And the weight sometimes, particularly for those of you who are strong believers, and understand that just because you're a strong believer doesn't mean that you're not going to go through. On top of all that, then you've got to deal with the weight of guilt that comes over you for doubting God and his promises. All of that together can be overwhelming. Do I have at least one witness in here? But I found something else out that tends to negate everything I just said. And that is that when we hold out and hold on to God, God who is ever faithful to his word, that God will come through. Amen. It may not be in the time that you anticipated it to be. It may not happen when you thought it should happen. But I've discovered through the living of these days that God will come through. I already told you that I feel like celebrating today because my wife and I, we went through the most agonizing 3 weeks of our lives. It was agonizing in a different way than we agonized over some of the personal things we went through separately before we even knew each other. But in this relationship with all the promises of God and the great hopes and dreams that we had, it was the most agonizing 3 weeks of our lives. Through absolutely no fault of our own, we went on without an address for what we had hoped would be just a few days, stretched out into 3 weeks. And in the midst of it, we had to manage our disappointment. We had to manage our frustration. We had to manage our anger. And we had to manage our pain. We could not believe that we were going through what we did. And even though God put us in a great place, surrounded by great people, and in the midst of that even gave us an assignment, we couldn't help wondering in the midst of it on different days, Lord, what are you doing? How long is this going to go on? Am I talking right, babe? How long are we going to endure this? I know you've never had that kind of situation before, and perhaps you ought to be up here preaching to me today. But here's something that many of you have discovered. And that is, for us, our trouble has come to an end. I already said it today. We close, we're in our house. That in and of itself is more than sufficient reason for us to celebrate today. But here's the interesting thing about it. I didn't come to just talk about today what God did through us, but here's what I've discovered, not just through this, but through so many of the things that we go through in our lives. That God, I believe, lets us go through those things because of something he wants to teach us in the midst of those things. I see some heads nodding. God knew, you see, before the foundations of the world that we would be in that situation. We were caught off guard, but God wasn't. God already knew exactly what he had planned and what he had established that would happen as a result of that. God let us go through it because of what he had planned for us. And that's what we learn from David as we read about David in our text today. Some of you, perhaps many of you, may remember this story, but for those of you who may be unfamiliar with it, let me tell you the story again. It's a marvelous story. It's a wonderful story. David is one of those colorful characters in the Bible. Love to talk about and read about David. This is one of my favorite stories. You may not know the history behind this story, but David brought a large group of people. In fact, it was 600 fighting men, not counting wives and children and livestock and everything that they had with them. And here he was fleeing into Philistine territory because he was fleeing from King Saul, who sought to kill him. The Bible tells us that as he fled, he asked the king of Gath to permit him to live in one of the towns near Gath. The king of Gath ruled not just Gath,
that was just his capital, but he also ruled the surrounding towns and the villages. David, you see, he desired a place where his group of people could live peaceably together. Now, most of those that were with him were from Israel. Probably all of them considered Israel's God to be their God. But David understood that if they lived in Gath, the false religion of Gath may have overtaken them, because they would constantly be aware of the ceremonies of that religion and the false gods that they worshipped. And so David realized that not all of his men were strong in their relationship with God. So he did not want them to be mixed in with those people, but instead desired a place where they could live together and not forget that they belonged to Israel. David, his request to Achish, king of Gath, was answered as he explained that he needed somewhere to live. Achish gave him a small town called Ziklag. Ziklag was a border town between Israel and Philistia. David became ruler of that town, and his men took their families to live there. For 16 months, he ruled that town under the authority of the king of Gath in Philistia. Now, the Bible tells us that David's men behaved well while they were in Ziklag, and that impressed the people that were there so much so that many of them, another 600 in fact, aligned themselves with David, presumably accepted David's God as their God. There's a whole message in there evangelistically that you might have just missed. It's important how you live. It's important how you walk before people. It's important that you understand that the example, realize that people are not just looking at you, they're watching you. They hear what you say. They see what you do. They see the things in which you participate, and they can tell very quickly when there is a disconnect between what you espouse and what you actually do. And so they were well behaved. And while under Achish's authority, David was a good follower of Achish. And he was willing to go to war even against his own countrymen in support of Achish. But when a war came and David showed up with his fighting men, Achish was glad to have him. But Achish's allies were not so convinced. Achish's allies, the lords of Philistia, they looked at David and they said, "I'm not sure about this. Isn't this David of whom the Israelites say that Saul has slain his thousands, but David has slain his tens of thousands? What happens if in the midst of the fighting, David suddenly remembers, hey, these are my cousins and my brothers and all these I'm fighting against, and turns and fights against us? No, David needs to go home." And so Achish comes to David and says, "I'm sorry about this, David, but they don't want you here. Now, you and I are cool, but for the sake of them, you need to go home." David wants to know, what is it that I did wrong? David didn't do anything wrong except he was successful. How many of you know you can't argue with success? Folk will fight against you over all kinds of things that you do, but they can't argue against success. So David grabs his 600 men and he goes home. And that's where our story begins. Because when he gets home to Ziklag, he discovers that all of their wives, all of their children, all of their livestock have been taken captive, and Ziklag itself is burned with fire. The interesting thing about this is that even in the midst of this, God was present,
Because the Bible is very specific. No one was killed. No one was killed. Do you know how improbable that is? Imagine 600 fighting men, that there was at least 4 to 5 times as many other people. When you count out wives and children and servants, and not to mention livestock, and nobody was killed, when an armed army comes and raids and burns with fire, y'all missing this. God was still present. That ought to let somebody know that no matter how difficult the situation is in which you find yourself, God is not absent. God is still present in it. I know sometimes we think, God, where are you? Because this is so horrible. If you were really here, things would be different. But sometimes God is right there in the midst of it, and even providing ways of escape that we just missed. God sometimes is there in the midst of it. So here they get to the place, they find that everybody is gone, and the men that be now you've got to go in the Old Testament and read about these fighting men. These were not just normal fighting men. These were DC Comics. Well, these were Marvel Comics type of warriors. These were mighty men of valor. These men by themselves, some of them, could fight off hundreds of men. They were powerful men. In fact, these were men's men. And yet the Bible says when they got back to Ziklag and discovered that their sweet thing and their babies were all gone, that they wept until they had no more strength to weep. Interesting thing about trouble is that after the initial anger and frustration and grief, it turns into retribution. Because now I've got to find a reason for why all this happened. The Bible says they turned on David, the man they had come out into the wilderness to follow. Do you all remember, Brother Ted, that passage of scripture where David's out in the wilderness and all these men are coming to him, and David looks at them and he asks one question. It's a question pastors ought to ask everybody that comes into their ministry. Why are you here? Are you here to help me or to hinder me? Sometimes we're so excited for numbers that unwittingly we let the devil in the house. Oh, y'all don't want to talk to me here. And we need to ask the question, why are you here? They had the right. Listen, these folks were, I get you to understand this. These folks were so committed to David that one time in the midst of warfare, David made one of those whimsical remarks. Oh, I'm so parched. It'd be so wonderful if I could have some water from that stream that runs through my daddy's property. Now they're in the midst of warfare. Some of the men, they fight their way through the front and go and get water from that brook and bring back to David. That's commitment. Wait a minute. That's not the end of the story. When David gets it, David says, you know what? This is not even right for me to drink of this water, because none of the rest of y'all get to do that. And he pours the water out on the ground. Y'all looking at, because you know some church members, if you did that to them, like, that'd be the last time. The last time I'd do anything for you. Get all super spiritual, Sister Bento, like, the devil. That's how committed they were to David. And yet these same men talked about stoning him. There's some things, leaders, because we're flesh and blood, we're human, that cut us to the core. And this had to hurt David.
And David was despondent. The Bible says that David encouraged himself. Have any of you ever been in a situation where you needed encouragement, but nobody around you was giving it? See, that's the moment you need to encourage yourself. That's the moment you need to say to yourself, self, this is not the time to die. This is not the time to lay down. This is not the time to give up. You know you're going the right way. You know you're doing what God called you to do. Get up from there. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. Sometimes in the morning you've had to get up and hold your head up, talk to yourself in the mirror. Because you know you're getting ready to go to work and you work with some devils. Come on. And you got to run into those folk and you need some encouragement. You yet to find your ministry or find that place where you can't help but going to work because you just love work. You just love where you work. Matter of fact, some of y'all, I'm talking to you right now, you're stuck at home and you're even beginning to miss some of the folk you didn't even like. I said beginning to. And you got to encourage yourself to get yourself ready. David bore the brunt of their pain. So what did David do? After he encouraged himself, he inquired of the Lord. I don't have time to go into the ephod. Sometime when you're studying the Word of God, go and look at that and study that. But he went and inquired of the Lord. And he was able, I believe, to inquire God's direction because he had faith. And as a result of his faith, he remembered and he witnessed afresh three things: God's provision, God's protection, and God's promises. In other words, he was able to look back over his shoulder and see down the road over which the Lord had brought him, how the Lord had been his provision, and how he had been his protection, and how he had made promises to him. And he knew without a doubt that the same God who came through for him then is the same God who is going to come through for him now. I want you to know today, whatever you're going through, the same God that saw you through that situation last week or last month or last year is the same God who's going to bring you through whatever you find yourself in right now. Listen, you don't need to go back to a time in history when I don't believe any of us were alive to talk about the Spanish flu. You've had struggles in your own life. You've had situations in your own life when you didn't think you were going to make it. And when the devil was convincing you that it's time for you to give up, you might as well quit. Go ahead and throw in the towel. Nothing's going to get any better. But you had a promise from God, and you held on to the promise of God, and God brought you through. Am I talking to anybody in here? It's the same. Look at somebody, tell them the same God who saw you through that. We'll see you through this. So three things I want you to get in mind. First of all, provision. The one thing that we need to remember when we're going through a situation is God's provision. Somebody say that. You see, David didn't just stumble up that day and have a relationship with God. David had an enduring relationship with God that had already been able to stand the test of time. David, you see, had a history, Bishop McElwain, with God that he could draw on. And that history extended way back to where he was a shepherd boy tending his father's sheep. David himself says this in 1 Samuel 17 when he's getting ready to go out against Goliath, and Saul wants to give him his armor. I'll say a little bit more about that. But he says this to him, your servant was tending his father's sheep when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock. I went after him and attacked him and rescued it from his mouth. And when he rose up against me, I seized him by his beard and I struck him and killed him. When he was saying this to Saul, he was a teenage boy. Now, let me tell you about this. He said a lion and a bear. Only the bravest and the strongest were able to kill a lion. Samson killed a lion. But David killed a lion and a bear. Listen, let me tell you about my wife for a moment. We were up in Maryland. My parents live up in the mountains in the woods. They have a wooded lot next to them. Our grandkids were out on the porch playing. They kept running inside. They said, Papa, there's a wolf outside. I said, a wolf? I went outside. The dogs were barking. It wasn't a wolf, but it was a mama bear with three cubs following close behind her, walking through. We were in a closed area. That bear wasn't paying us any mind. One of the cubs ran up the tree to see what all the barking was about, and then we could hear the mother bear grunting. That a cub came running down and ran after his mother. They kept on going. It was like they were out for an afternoon stroll, and we were looking at this bear walking through, and I turned around to say, baby, you see that? Baby, my wife was gone. She wasn't even looking out the window. She was listen. He not only fought them, he attacked them. Y'all missing this. Rarely will folk go into a battle knowing it's a dangerous situation. But he went after them and attacked them. And then it said, and when they turned on him to come against him, he grabbed them by the beard and slew them. How could he do that except God was with him? How could he do that except God was making provision for? Listen, let me tell you something here. You're stronger than you think you are. Amen. You have more endurance than you think you do. You're more resilient than you think you are. You can take a licking and, like the Timex commercial said, and keep right on ticking, not because of your own self, but because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. The devil is counting on you fighting and running and giving up. But I remember Jesus talking to Peter, and when he said to Peter, the devil has desired to sift you. But then Jesus says a three-word conjunction that negates everything said before it. He says, but I have prayed for you. God has made provision for you. It's not that whatever you're in is not tough. It's not that whatever you're in does not have the potential to kill you. But understand this. You need to be able to speak to your situation and say, listen, you should have gotten me before I came into relationship with Jesus. You should have gotten me before I came to the knowledge of his love for me. You should have gotten me before I discovered his authority and his power. But since you arrived on the scene too late, let me tell you something. God has made provision for me, and I'm going to put a bruising on your head. I'm going to step all over you because my God is with me. Isn't that what Jesus said? I'll never leave you nor forsake you. I'll be with you sometimes. I'll be with you always to the very close of the age. Stop acting like Henny Penny. The sky is falling. The sky is falling. And recognize that God plus one is always. Did you hear that? The second thing. Are y'all okay? You don't have to rush and go eat because they're serving food for us afterwards. So that means I can preach until about 6 o'clock. The second thing is God not only gives you protection, but God gives you protection. When David, teenager, somebody say teenager. We're talking about
Howard Jr., are you a teenager yet? Howard, what are you, 12? Almost 12. So he's a tweenie, but not much bigger than him. We're talking about a boy. And if you remember, David asks his father Jethro for permission to go to the front to visit his brothers and take them some food. And when he gets there, his brothers, along with the armies of Israel, are all cowering in fear because the Philistines have put forth a champion by the name of Goliath. They have so much confidence in this 9-foot behemoth of a man that they said, send one of your warriors out. And if you can defeat him, we'll go off in defeat. But if we defeat you, you will be subjected to us. And nobody would go out day after day, day after day. David went out and he looked and, why aren't all y'all going out against him? What's wrong with y'all? I can imagine at that point, David, who idolized his big brothers, that David suddenly encountered a moment of reality. These dudes are not as bad as I thought they were. Y'all, come on. Little boys with their big brothers, they tend to grow up thinking, my brother can do anything. I'm sure David idolized his big brothers. And check this out. It's his big brothers that were all passed over when Samuel came to anoint a new king. Even though some of them looked like a king. Come on, somebody. And so David says, you know what? If none of y'all going out, I'll go. So they take him to the king. And when he tells the king, king's like, you can't, you just a boy. You can't go out. And David says, yeah, I can. I'm going. And Saul says, well, if you're going to go, you need some protection. So King Saul offers him the use of his armor. But note 1 Samuel 17, verses 38 through 40. Then Saul clothed David with his garments and put a bronze helmet on his head, and he clothed him with armor. David girded his sword over his armor and tried to walk, for he had not tested them. So David said to Saul, I cannot go with these, for I have not tested them. And David took them off. He took his stick in his hand and chose for himself 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in the shepherd's bag, which he had even in his pouch, and his sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistine. Now, when I was in seminary, I had a preaching professor who used to always say, when you read scripture, it ought to be like there's a hole in the back of your head. And you're looking through that hole out your eyes. And the Bible's coming alive before you like a panoramic movie. And so with my spiritual imagination, I see David, helmet too big, coming down over his eyes, about down to his nose. I see David with the armor just hanging off him. I see David with the sword around his waist, dragging the floor, and David trying to walk. It's too heavy. It's too cumbersome. But David had already made up his mind that I'm going to do this thing. See, David understood something. David understood that he didn't need human armor because he already had armor of a different type. He understood that he was surrounded by everything that he needed. Saul's armor didn't fit him. I'm not talking about size-wise. Saul's armor didn't fit him. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. There's some things that folk want to recommend to you, but it doesn't fit you. There's some things that folk recommend you do, but it doesn't fit you. There's some remedies that folk want to give to you, but it doesn't fit you.
My God. Bishop McElwain is a pharmacist, but he will also tell you, Grandmama wasn't entirely ignorant. Grandmama knew something with some of those remedies that she had. You see, sometimes there's some things that are not going to fit you. And if you've learned anything in living, you should have learned that what will be most effective in your situation is what will fit you. Are y'all hearing me? Yeah, I can't try to be like everybody else because that's not me. I can't do what you do because that's not me. I've got to do what I know to do. I've got to do what fits me. David went out with what fit him. What fit him? A slingshot. And 5 smooth stones. And if you remember the story, David walked out against this 9-foot giant who had a javelin and a spear and a sword. And Goliath was no doubt laughing. Oh, this is the best y'all could do? You send me a little boy? I could chew him up and spit him out. I can ball him up in a little ball. Take his legs and tie him in a knot. That's what I'm going to do, and I'm going to throw him right back at you. And David, because he had to protect, I love this part. David's walking out there in the field against him, this big behemoth of a man. And David looks at him and says, who is this uncircumcised Philistine coming against me with a sword and a spear and a javelin? You come against me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord. And he took, it didn't even take all 5, it only took one. He took one of those stones, he put it in the slingshot. The old preacher said, and he circled it. See, the slingshot he used was not the kind that some of y'all grew up with, you know, the shape of a Y that you pull like this. It was a string with 2 ends on it. And you put that stone in it, and you slung it around. You slung it around and released it. You released one of the strings, and he was so good at that thing. He had been practicing with predators coming against the sheep, and he hit Goliath right between the eyes, knocked him down on the ground. Now the Bible says that he died. But I ask myself, if he died, why then did he take Goliath's sword and cut off his head? I believe he did it. It hadn't been invented yet, but he did it so that nobody later on could come by with a fibrillator and bring him back to life. I'm here to tell somebody, when you use what fits you and operate knowing that if God be for me, he's more than the world against me. If God will go with me, I shall overcome. He went out against them, but he also recognized, I'm not going to leave the devil a chance to come back against me. So let me cut this fool's head off so that he can't come back up against me. It's not enough just to claim deliverance. You got to step back up there and cut it off so that it never comes back again. So that you don't walk around saying, I'm a recovering addict. Or I'm a recovering alcoholic. Or I'm a recovering whatever. But you can walk around and say, I am delivered. I am healed. I am set free. And I'll never go back because God brought me through. Woo! Glory to God. Glory to God. Sit. I got one more and I'm done. Lady McElwain just shaking her head at me. She's shaking her head talking about that, Logan. What you gonna do? She and I've been friends longer than she and her husband and I've been friends. I know what she's thinking already. I'm looking at her. She's sitting there shaking her head talking. That Logan. Lord have mercy. God gives us provision, protection, Here's the part I really like, because here's the part that sustained us. I thank God that he sustained us. But the part that sustained us the most was we had a promise. Oh God. Ah, you see, you've got something when you have a promise, because God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should go back on his word. If he said it, he will do it. If he promised it, doesn't matter how long it takes, it shall come to pass. Come here, Abraham. Abraham was 100 years old, and his wife was 99 years old. Her womb had already closed up, and Abraham needed some Viagra. Come on, somebody. But God caused his sperm to have vitality, and for Sarah's womb to be receptive, and Isaac came forth. But it was tens of years before when God promised that I'll make your descendants as many as the stars of the sky or the sands of the ocean. And he hung right there in it. Well, listen here. David had a testimony similar to that, because David was anointed king over Israel. And Judah, though he would not sit on the throne for years to come. Why? Because Saul was still king. Look at the word of God, 1 Samuel 16, verses 12 through 13. So he sent and brought him in. This is Samuel when he went to anoint one of Jethro's sons. God just told Samuel, here's the great thing Bintu, when God gives you an instruction, he doesn't always make it plain. Somebody knows what I'm talking about. God told you to go down that street, but he didn't tell you what you were going to do when you got down there. God told Samuel, go to Jethro's house and anoint one of his sons as the next king. He didn't tell him which one. So Samuel was left trying to figure it out on his own. And after when he looked at one of the sons and said, surely this is the next king. And God said, that ain't it. Then another one came and God said, he's not it either. And God said to Samuel, the problem is, you look on the outer person, but I look on their heart. I look what's on the inside. And he went through all the sons. And he looked at Jethro and he said, don't you have any more sons? Isn't it interesting that Jethro didn't even invite David to come in? It was like David wasn't even one of the sons. David, he left out in the field. David's got work to do. He's the youngest. Surely he's not the next king. But as soon as David came in, so he sent and brought him in. Now he was ready. That's David. He was ready. In other words, he hadn't had a bath. He was out there with the sheep. He probably had the dirt and stuff from being out there, sheep all over him, and probably smelled like one too. Said he was ruddy. But he had beautiful eyes. He had a handsome appearance. And the Lord said to Samuel, arise, anoint him, for this is he. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. Woo, God, hear me, somebody. God's getting ready to raise you up out of the midst of your situation and right in the midst of the very people who betrayed you, right in the midst of the very people who talked about you, right in the midst of the very people who underestimated you, right in the midst of the people who said you'll never be anything. God will anoint you. And it says that when he anointed him in the presence of his brothers, the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward, and Samuel rose and went to Ramah. God, oh, I love this. You see, right there at that moment, David was made king. But he didn't have the throne. David was anointed king, but he didn't sit on the throne. It would be years before he sat on the throne. Now, some of you will try to be like Moses, who, when he was 40 years old, he decided it was time for him to take over leadership of the Israelites. And they're like, who are you? You're not one of us.
You've been living up there in the king's house, eating the king's food, wearing the king's clothing, and you presume to come down here and lead us? And don't think you did something because you killed one of our taskmasters. All that's going to do is make them come down on us harder. He had to flee for 40 years. Come on, somebody. See, sometimes you'll try to, can I say this? How many of you have the testimony that you got into trouble and it was entirely your own fault because you got ahead of God? Anybody know what it's like to get out in front of God? And if you're like me, Brother Howard, if you're like me and you have a word from the Lord, God speaks it, and God's emphatic what he wants you to do, and you jump in and you try to do it, and it fails. For me, I'm back in the presence of God sniffing and snotting and crying, but Lord, you told me to do it. Here's God's response. Yes, but I didn't say today. Brother Sattar, how many of you know that timing is important? God's timing is important. David understood that. David didn't go to the king's house saying, hello, y'all, I'm here, I'm the new king. David bided his time. Even when he had the opportunity, when he was running from Saul to kill him, and even when his partners encouraged him to kill him, nobody will know. They don't even know we're up in this cave. David refused because he said Saul mightn't have been taken down in terms of God's anointing, but he's still the set man. And I will not be the one. One of the things I hate about churches, and listen, is sometimes they forget that it's not their job to do God's work of discipline. God will do his discipline. Let me tell you something. God will do it. But see, some church members, I can remember when I was in the Presbyterian church and I had a board, and the congregation would elect people to sit on that board. I'd have people that got elected to the board, and their whole reason for being on that board is they wanted to keep me in line. That's not your job. David understood that. Because why? He had the promises of God. What promises has God made you? I don't care how old you may be. I don't care how long you have been waiting. Can I say this to you? You cannot even die until God's promises in your faithfulness have come to pass. Come on, somebody. Are you hearing me? You're sitting up here talking about, but God, you said you were going to do this. It didn't happen. No. God hadn't forgotten about you. God still knows where you live. God still knows your name. Ah. I was talking about this on Wednesday night. We had trouble getting it up on YouTube for some reason, but we had a sort of impromptu panel situation, and I kind of looked at Lady Cece, and I said, baby, we hadn't even talked about this, but do you realize that when we were in the midst of all of this and time was going on and the house we were buying, you know, there's like a 14-day window after you're supposed to close, that if you don't close within those 14 days, at the end of those 14 days, the seller can put the house back on the market. And our realtor had come to us and said, he says day 14, he's putting it back on the market. And we suddenly got despondent because we realized, listen, everything's getting held up at this particular point. And if we have to go back in to buy another house, there's money that we're going to lose. We got to come up with some more money. And then if we found another house that next day, it would be at least 21 days before we could close and we'd be home. I mean, we were just going through. And an interesting thing began to happen. We began to start talking about the house that we were buying and all the little things about it that we didn't like. And I all of a sudden realized that what we were doing is we were disconnecting. Y'all not hearing me. We were disconnecting in case we didn't get the house. And the reason why I bring this up, because I believe it was on Friday when we were in the house and Lady Cece went out to do some things and I was in the house by myself. And I was walking around that house. And I was looking at everything, and I was getting turned around and twisted. And I remember hollering to the Lord, Lord, I love this house. God, I love every single part of this house. And it suddenly dawned on me
you started to doubt me. But I had made you a promise. Y'all not hearing me. Y'all not hearing me. I had made you a promise. See, you've got to understand this. It's not that you're not going to go through something. You're going to go through something. You may be in something right now. And listen, don't get all happy just because you come out of it. Our preacher said one time, we're always in one of three conditions. Going into a situation, in a situation, or coming out of a situation. How many of you know the truth of that? Amen. Amen. Murphy's Law seems to kick in at sometimes. If it's not one thing, it's another. And everything that can go wrong will go wrong. But here we have resources because we're not left alone. When we go through, it's God who will bring you through. It's God who will see you through. Listen, we are standing where we are today. We're living where we are today. We're enduring what we're enduring today because of the provision of God. And listen, let me tell you, the devil's just as busy as he can be. We were staying with the Howards and parked my car on the road and came out to discover that somebody had sideswiped my car and didn't even say anything, left it off. You know what? My first inclination with my nice, beautiful new car was to fall on my knees and begin bemoaning the fact. And before I could even go that way, I heard the Lord say, it's just a material thing. Don't you realize I've got more for you than just this? But see, the enemy was coming along to try to pour more cold water on our joy. Listen, I'm going to tell you again that joy comes from the Lord. Joy is not artificially stimulated. Joy comes through the Lord. And even in the midst of your negative situation, even in the midst of your crying times, you can still have the joy of the Lord and know that God will bring you through. I don't know how many of you have the testimony today that I've been in something. I've gone through some things. And the reason why I'm standing here today is because God brought me through. Now I'm standing here today. I might have a limp in my hip, like Joseph at Peniel, who wrestled with an angel and said, I refuse to release you until you bless me. And even the angels trying to get away pulled his hip out of socket. And Joseph ended up with a limp because of his experience at Peniel. Sometimes God will leave you with a little something just so you remember that it's God who brought you through. It's God who opened the door for you. It's God who made a way out of no way for you. God will bring you through, but don't you ever forget, it wasn't your goodness. It wasn't your knowledge. It wasn't your money. It wasn't your associations. It was the Lord who brought you out. Do I have one witness in here that would say, I'm glad that the Lord made a way out of no way? Can I go back home for just a little while and remember the old songwriter that said, I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry and from the waters lifted me. Now safe am I. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. That's why I'm able to stand today. I might not be able to run like I used to. I might not be able to do the things I used to do. But the greatest testimony that I have is I'm still here. Look at somebody and tell them, you're still here because God brought you through. And the same God who's bringing you through this today is the same God who will bring you through tomorrow. Do I have a witness in here? God will come through for you. Amen. Is this ministering to anybody? Stand to your feet. I'm finished. I'm done. I'm done. I'm done. Glory to God. I praise God for a stable Wi-Fi today. I'm seeing all kinds of people checking in and watching us, and I see all of you that are watching us. I want you to know God will come through for you. Whatever you're going through,
Don't you let it get you down. Don't you let it be, make you despondent. God will bring you through. COVID-19 is nothing for God. Hallelujah. Political instability is nothing for God. Social unrest is nothing for God. Racial tension is nothing for God. Classism is nothing for God. Colorism is nothing for God. God will bring you through. If you believe it, somebody shout glory. Somebody shout glory. So hold on, my sister. Hold on, my brother. I can't wait to see what God will do for you. Amen. 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 Glory to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. We bless the Lamb of God. Amen. Did this minister to you? Blessed be God. Amen. I want you to go out of here today knowing that God's going to come through for me. Amen. Amen. And when you go through your next struggle, you go through your next challenge, I want you to stand up like you got a whole army behind you and let them know you messed with the wrong one today. Go ahead, devil. Do your worst. God's going to bring me through. God's going to bring me through. How many of you know sometimes when the devil attacks you and knocks you down, you got to tell the devil, that was good. That was a good shot. That was a good shot. That was a great shot. That belly shot knocked me to the ground. But just one mistake you made. You let me get up. And while I'm up, I'm coming back to get everything you took from me. David said, shall I pursue? God said, go get it, for you shall recover all. Can I tell somebody that's watching, whatever you've lost during these months, whatever you have put on the back burner, whatever the devil's stolen away from you, don't you sit there. Go get your stuff. And God says, you shall recover all. Amen. Glory to God. God be praised. Now listen, if you're listening to me, I have something I need to tell you, very important. And that is that if you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, nothing that I said will make any sense to you. The activation for this word is a personal relationship. One of the things I hear all the time, and it bugs the stew out of me, is that we're all the children of God. Lie. I went by a church the other day, had on the marquee, we're all the children of God. I wanted to find a black can of spray paint and just go spray on top of that sign, John chapter 1, verse 12. For as many as received him, gave he the right to become the sons of God. Amen. If you don't have a personal relationship, I don't care how many crystals you got hanging. I don't care how often you go to the mosque. I don't care how many Sung Young Ming Cho you mutter meditating. I don't care how many temples you go to with Krishna and all the, none of that matters. Only a relationship with Jesus will get you the breakthrough you're looking for. No self-help book can give it to you. I don't care how many hundreds of dollars you pay per month going for counseling. Hallelujah. And I'm not casting cold water on counseling. Dr. McElwain is a counselor. You need counseling. But after you receive counseling, you need to come get some prayer and spiritually cut the head of that giant off so it can't get back up again. And if you don't know Jesus today, it's my pleasure to offer him to you. You don't have to click your heels three times and say anything. It's as simple as this. Believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you shall be saved. If you're not saved today and you believe that, I want you to repeat this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, you all repeat it with me just so somebody's repeating it. Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner and I deserve judgment. Forgive me for all my sin. I freely give my life to you. I freely accept you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name. Now, if you prayed that prayer and you believed it when you prayed it, guess what? You're saved. The whole host of heaven is rejoicing right now. I want you to do something. I want you to put in the comment field that you gave your life to Jesus so that we can be in touch with you and get you on the right path. We'll get you a Gideon Bible so that you can have the Word of God, because we want you to grow in the Lord. Amen. And if you've fallen back on your relationship, you can come back today. Just tell the Lord, I'm sorry. Resolve to turn around. That's what it means to repent. And God will reactivate your life in Jesus' name. Do you all believe it today? Hallelujah. So I thank God for you. I'm looking around. We're all family today. And I bless God for you. How many of you got a blessing from the Lord? I want to thank God for my good friends, the Gideons, being with us today. We bless God for you. Amen. Deacon Angela, I know you're on the line watching, so I need you to come this week, and I need you to write a check from us to the Gideons. Send me a text message. I'll tell you how much. Did we make it out right to Gideon's International? Amen. Because we want to be in the number to be part of that. We want to be able to say that as a church, we support missionaries in over 200 countries of the world. Amen. Amen. We bless God for you. Amen. Lift your hands before the Lord, because I'm done. It's time to go eat. Hallelujah. Lift your hands before the Lord. As a bishop in the Lord's church, I bless you to be a blessing. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, I bless you in the name of Jesus to walk in wholeness of health. In the name of Jesus, I bless your breadbasket. I bless you in your rising up and your lying down, in your going and in your coming, in Jesus' name. Now go in peace, love and serve the Lord, and the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ be with you now and forever. Amen. Amen. And amen. Come on. Shout us up out of here. If you're still in the room, stop where you right where you are and listen to me for a second. We gave in this room today just under $500. That $500 allows us to reach 225,400 people. That amount today will supply 98 of those hotel Bibles and or 395 of the little testaments. Now, I believe they've got some of those for us today that they're going to distribute to anybody who wants one of those little testaments, and I hope everybody will take it, even our young people, take a testament with you. So they're going to come lay this on the altar that God might increase it. Amen. I just wanted you to have that information so that you'd know what you did today. Amen. Amen. And their hope is the testament that you give today, that you will use it to give it away to share Christ with somebody like Sebastian. And then bring the information. I'll have a little pink card in it. Bring the information back to me. This is accountability. Amen. Don't set it up on the shelf with your other Bible and let it collect dust. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Stretch your hands towards the pulpit. Let's join them as we consecrate this that it might increase. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Blessed be God. Blessed be God.
Our Father and our God, we thank you for that which you have done here today. Lord, we have no way of knowing, but through our physical eyes, it looks like checks and currency. But to your eyes, Father, you see changed lives. You see those that are broken and hurting put back together again. And you see peace upon those that are represented here as it flows out of this lighthouse, across this world, through this city. Father, we pray that your peace would be upon these. Lord, we pray that salvation would come to tens of thousands out of this envelope. Father, we thank you for this lighthouse. We thank you for the word that is being preached. But now, Father, we pray your blessing as you multiply upon this. In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
All of God's people said,
Amen. Glory to God. Glory, glory, amen.